Hey everybody, now welcome to the Live on Four Legs YouTube channel, and today we're pretty deep into the album list, so we're getting towards the end. Today we're covering Backspacer, and you know, this is an album that came out like 12 years ago now, and at first when the album came out, everybody was really, really hyped on it because it felt like Pearl Jam was kind of going back to an older style. Brendan O'Brien was back in the fold, so that was really important to a lot of people. And for a lot of people, this was kind of like Pearl Jam going back to what they thought was, you know, something more original and unique. And I think that having Obama as president, I know this for a fact because it's been stated on interviews, having Obama as president at this time and no longer George Bush, it helped the mentality because Ed really felt like, okay, we're going in the right direction here. Our country's in the right direction. So honestly, a lot of these songs fit more positive sort of themes here instead of like on Avocado and Riot Act, where the themes kind of get a little bit dark, a little bit depressing at times. But here, no, it's, if you look at these songs, all these songs have some positivity factor to them, besides maybe the end. So we're going to get into it. Yeah, this is not my favorite album. It's not my favorite album, but there are some people that are die-hard Backspacer fans that live and die with the record. And I think most people that are, a lot of them are younger Pearl Jam fans. And I don't say that as a demeaning thing. I don't say that to kind of separate them from the pack, like that young fans like newer albums or something like that. But it's because, and I think of what, you know, what my history was with Yield. And when, you know, kids in their early late 20s right now, when Backspacer came out, they were, you know, like in high school, they were in middle school, so they were trying to get their hands on music for the first time, the same way I did with Yield. So the newest thing, the thing that feels fresh the most, is going to resonate in their heads, and that's what Backspacer was. And for a lot of young Pearl Jam fans, they will live and die by Backspacer, which is fine. It's just, I liked it when it came out. I liked it after a couple years, but then after a while, the songs, it just didn't continue to grow. And that just happens, but, you know, we can get into that as when the time goes on. So let's get into ranking Backspacer. It's going to be difficult because I'm not sure where anything's going to go. First up is Gonna See My Friend. Gonna See My Friend was probably one of my favorite songs when the album came out. And I've sort of steered away from it a little bit. I used to think it was one of their best album openers, and I don't anymore. I sort of steered away, but I still think it's a good song. And the reason why I steered away is because live, it seems to be down-tuned, and I've talked about this before. I don't like songs when they're down-tuned for some reason. It bothers me. So especially that's such a newer song, that why wouldn't you write that in a key that Ed's able to pick up on? And it just, you know, for live sake, I like things kind of sounding the way they are, and if they don't, then it kind of disrupts my listening. But overall, I think the song is great. I think that solo to kind of start out really kicks you off for the record, and I've heard a lot of people talk about Gonna See My Friend in the same way that I've talked about Brandon J. The only differences there is that Backspacer is such a clean record. And I mean that by this. It's such a clean record that the production is clean on it. It's just, like, it feels crisp opposed to No Code, that feels a little bit, like, hollow, opposed to Yield, that has kind of a different feel to it that's neither the first nor the last. But, yeah, this is an album that feels like it's a little too overproduced sometimes. And I think for a punk rock song to really start your album, it felt too poppy. It felt too poppy. So what I'm going to do with this one, I'm actually a little torn on this one. I think it's in between 1 and 2 for right now. Let's see where we go. I know in the past couple weeks, I've been saying, you know, at least 5 are going to go in the first tier. This is an 11-song album. I don't know if that's going to work on this, but we will work things out. We'll see where it goes, and we'll make it good. Okay, the next song, number 2, is Got Some. A lot of people that know me pretty well know that I am not a fan of Gotsum. I don't love the song. I think it kind of came from live where, you know, I would go see them a lot in 2013 after Backspacer was out during the Lightning Bolt tour. And there's some songs that stick with that and some that kind of peered away, which we'll get to. But Gotsum stick with the pack. But not only that, Gotsum was utilized in the encore more often than not. And it felt like a lot of times that I was going to shows, Gotsum was part of the encore. I'm just like, why? What's the point of this? I would rather have something, you know, fresher, like, and by fresher, I mean something like Breath, something like, you know, Smile, or something that is unique to an encore. Because when you look at set lists from 2013 that have Gotsum in the encore, you kind of look at them like, that kind of sours it a little bit. I think some of the things with the song too that bother me is that it's kind of a repetitive chorus, and Pearl Jam has never done this like real repetitive poppy chorus where it's kind of chanty, it's kind of like it would be need to be an arena song type deal. Got some if you need, like, I just don't think that those lyrics are anything special. So here's what I'm thinking with Got Some. Look, I know that a lot of people do like it, and I think I've turned people on, I've turned people off to it, and I honestly, like, I'm gonna give it a little credit because it was a song that did stick around from Backspacer. Not a lot of them did. But yeah, Gotsum's in the second tier. The Fixer, like, it's the same conversation here. The Fixer was really nice when it first came out. I was really into it. It was pretty poppy. And then once the Lightning Bolt tour hit, whenever they played The Fixer, it was like, not really feeling this one anymore. I will say on The Fixer front, though, that I've listened to versions recently, and sometimes I get in this mode of, like, wow, okay, The Fixer can be a really fun song, because, believe it or not, The Fixer could be a really fun song. But it's also, like, it felt artificial in a way that they were trying to build some sort of anthemic type song. And when I go back and I listen to the Matt Cameron demo that's on PJ20 of this, and it's called Need to Know, and that is how the song should sound. It's like a little bit dark, it's a little bit riffy, a little more riffy, and like it just has some bite to it. The Fixer, along with a lot of these songs, it's just very bubbly. And I don't know if I put it in the second or third tier. That's really tough. It had some significance when it first came out. But right now, like, you'll never find it in a set. It's almost never gonna happen. So, I don't know. I'll put it in between 2 and 3 for now and figure it out later. How about that? Johnny Guitar, I don't have to spend a lot of time on because it is one of Pearl Jam's, I want to call it worst songs, but I will call it one of Pearl Jam's missed opportunities, I'll call it. It has a fun concept, but it's just totally cheesy. The lyrics are cheesy, the sentiment is cheesy, and like I get it, like, okay, you know, this is kind of like a story of a teenager that sees a girl on his wall and hopes that one day the girl will come and find him through his window. Like, I get that, and kind of the idea of like Johnny Guitar Watson gets all the chicks and stuff like that. It just, I don't know, it doesn't feel like much of a Pearl Jam song, and boy, I don't think the band really stuck with this one either. It's only been played about 15 times. So I think this is an easy third tier. And I think that a lot, unfortunately, there are a lot on this record that you could say that about, but when we get to it, we can get to it. When other songs, it's gonna be tough, but I might even convince myself that they're better than what they are. But we're about to actually go through a pretty hot streak here with the next three songs, starting with Just Breathe. And look, Just Breathe was an instant hit with everybody that, you know, when the album came out, it was a love song, it was a love anthem. And what I think happened was this kind of became Pearl Jam's song of the late 2000s in a way that maybe you know, like an Alive and Even Flow were to 1992 through 1995, Better Man in that kind of sense too, Just Breathe really took over from 2009 on, and it's been heavily played. It's a song that I know very well because it was my wedding song, so every time it comes up, you know, my wife gets a tear in her eye and we sing to it and stuff like that. I don't want to get too sappy, but yeah, like it's very good. It's a very well-written song. The lyrics are really, really well done, phenomenal, especially with everything that's on the board. I think that this is pretty easy to put in the first tier. That's fine. I have no problem with that at all. Amongst the Waves, again, you're hitting pretty heavy with these three songs in a row. And Amongst the Waves, I liked it at first. I liked it pretty well at first. And then I was kind of off it a little bit. Once I was off Backspacer, I was off Amongst the Waves. However, in correlation to the story that I just told about Just Breathe, how that was my wedding song, Amongst the Waves was actually a song that I heard in the car when driving back the next day from the wedding, driving back to my house, and I had on Sirius Radio, and Amongst the Waves came on. I'm like, whoa, this is exactly how I feel right now. This is really uplifting. And I had a real fun time just like taking the song in and really appreciating it, and it kind of gave new life to what the song is a little bit. So I think there's not much, and look, it's a great song that kind of, in a way, raises awareness for our oceans, and it's very pro-climate change, and it's happening, and everybody has to kind of take care of it, or else what we love out of, you know, Mother Nature and the beach, that'll be gone. Amongst the Waves is a first-tier song for me. I think that's an easy decision. And now we go to Unthought Known. Again, like the three-headed monster of Backspacer right here. I don't think this is much of a surprise to anybody, but Unthought Known was the kind of song, and from what I know that a friend had told me in his one interaction with Mike McCready, was that he was talking to him, and somehow he ended up talking to him about Unthought Known. And Mike said that on the record, he didn't quite know what to think of it. And then when playing it live, he got it. He got the gist of what it was. And that solo, that's very atmospheric. It's very anthemic. It can take you to like very high levels and just kind of gets you going, gets you moving. Unthought Known was the live song off of this record. And it didn't start out that way, but it definitely evolved into it. I think a lot of fans picked up on some of the lyrics, picked up on some of the bright spots, and think about it. Whenever you go to a show, they play it, you think about the Gems and Rhinestones line, like that's how many people go out and sing that. Like, that's such a great line. And a lot of the lyrics in the song are fantastic too. So yeah, I think this is an easy first tier song as well. And again, you got four more here that I really don't know what to do with, but we'll figure it out. I used the Supersonics logo for Supersonic, and, you know, of course there was play on words in there, and I think at the time the Sonics were still a team, but not for very long. Maybe one more year they spent in Seattle before moving out to Oklahoma City, but I think Supersonics were on their mind, even though the song isn't quite about basketball. But what I do like is when they played Oklahoma City, Ed went through a whole big spiel about them moving to the city and how the owners, I don't know the full story, but I can't say that I've actually listened to that full Oklahoma City show, but there is a good moment where Ed is talking shit about the Oklahoma City Thunder owners that moved from Seattle. So with the song, it's a punk song, but it's a very clean punk song. As I mentioned before, we're going to see my friend. Clean punk songs don't do much for me. I like it when they're gritty. I like them when they're a little tough. And this one just feels very polished to me. And it's okay to be polished, but that's not... Look, if this was kind of cutting edge and had a little bite and had a little bit less of that kind of slide in there, that little thing in the beginning with noon and noon and noon, like, I don't know. I thought that was kind of lame. I don't know. I think it's third tier. because I don't really know what else to do with it. I don't think it does belong in the second tier. It's fine. It's fine for what it is, but gee, it could be so much better. It could really be so much better. All right, we're going to hit on Speed of Sound now, and that, I think, is such a cool song. And I know, again, with the production of the album, it is another one that's kind of overproduced, yeah. And if you listen to the demo version of Speed of Sound, you'll be able to kind of hear the rawness coming from Ed. And that's such an interesting aspect from it, you know, just main acoustic. And it feels, again, like there's a lot less piano and there's a lot, it's more opened up. It just has a distinct sound to it, but I still think the song is good. It's only been played 7 times live, and that's because they've never been able to get the hang of it. It's got a weird, unique kind of rhythm, and, you know, sometimes that can throw the band off a little bit, and if you went to that Philly show at the Spectrum, you'll kind of know what I'm talking about here. They tried it, and it kind of bummed them out, so it didn't really work, and for that, I think I'm going to put it in the second tier, because I still do think it's a good song, but I think that there are aspects of it that could feel better, that could feel more raw, and again, this album's way too polished for that to happen on, so yeah, not part of that. Force of Nature, I never really grew to the song too much. I don't know why, but I kind of just didn't. Just didn't really attach to me, didn't have much of anything. But anyway, like, and the band too, the last time they played it live was at Madison Square Garden in 2010. That's a long time ago. I believe it was like only 11 times played. So the band, this is a deep cut off the album. They're not thinking about it. I don't know in the future if a lot of these deep cut Backspacer songs are going to be stuff that they go to, like Johnny Guitar and Speed of Sound and Force of Nature and Gonna See My Friend. I just don't think they have a lot of tread on their tires. You know, like, they're just kind of going to sit there on the shelf a little bit. But yeah, Force of Nature, it doesn't do too much for me. And I don't know, I guess kind of at the end, it has sort of a soaring aspect to it. But when you think about it, it didn't work that way live. And there are too many songs that kind of build off of what Unthought Known had. And after a while on the record, you're just like, that's enough. Let's get some depth here. The one thing I will say about the record, even though I'm not the biggest fan of this record, the one thing I will say, it is really well done in the track listing and the way that it flows. Because I think that's very important, that you need album to flow really well, and I think that this does have a lot of balance when it comes to that. But I think Force of Nature kind of does stuff that some of the other songs do a little bit better, so I think it's going in the third tier. We are on the last one, The End, and The End is a song that usually, you know, it's basically solo Ed. I never seen a version, heard a version where the rest of the band is on it, and when you think about it, there's only like a string section and a little bit of a faint organ on the album version. It's not a song I've listened to in a very long time, but you know, it kind of, I guess when it first came out, it kind of had this mystique to it, like, you know, what is he signaling here, what's the song about? And you'd think like, oh, is this the end? Is this their last studio album? Which, no, of course not. Of course it wasn't going to be that. But I don't know. I think it kind of, it fits in with the Just Breathe aspect, that those two can kind of bounce off of it. While Just Breathe is right in the middle, The End is right at the, well, I don't have to go through that. But yeah, the song doesn't do too much for me, unfortunately. You know, a couple times when they played it with strings, I think it really worked. It was very good. But yeah, I don't quite know, and the best I can do with it, I think, is third tier, which means I have some work to do with the second and the third, so I'm going to just go ahead and bump stuff up. No, Got Some. Got Some is before The Fixer. Get out of there. I'm going to move The Fixer up to the second tier, if it'll let me. Because at least, like, it was the first single, at least, you know, it was the one that they promoted a real lot with. Is it one that stuck around? No, but at least it had a little bit of depth. And For that, I think I'm going to put Gonna See My Friend on the board. And I won't even put it in the competition for what the S tier is, but we do have four. It's really going to just be a three-song battle. I'm okay with Gonna See My Friend being in the S tier because I think that people need to give that a better listen because it's a pretty explosive song when it first starts. So what we do here is just breathe in the middle, amongst the waves in the middle, unthought known in the middle. This is a little challenging because I think that when I think of these, you know, what's going to be an S tier song, I think about one that sort of defines the record and is kind of kept pretty high standing of what Pearl Jam is and what they've always been. And I think that they all kind of do that, but the one that does it the least is probably Amongst the Waves. It doesn't have as much staying power. It's very, very good. But I think that these are giants right here. I think that these are big, big, big songs that it just kind of makes the competition just between the two of them. So the argument here is, do I go with kind of, you know, the era of 2009 was one that kind of turned, it really put them in full force dad ed mode and dad band mode. And Just Breathe was a very definitive song of that. When Avocado was kind of the transition, it had a song called Parachutes, obviously. And that, you know, it was a love song, but it didn't quite click in the same way. Just Breathe has clicked. It's stayed around, and it's become a song very, very quotable. And a lot of people love to put the quote on their wall and stuff like that. But then Unthought Known, it has the same presence. It's one that, you know, everybody live just gets a big bounce out of, and I usually gravitate towards those songs. And most of the songs that I have that have been chosen for the list are those kind of songs that really grab you and put a lot of energy and emphasis on the song. So Just Breathe would be kind of a, you know, kind of a deferment from that, but Unthought Known, that's really tough to leave it out. It's really tough to leave it out here because I think it has made such a difference, but both of them, I'm inclined to say Unthought Known, but Just Breathe is very, 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 very close in a second. They have definitely have two different stylistic points, and I think that Unthought Known overall, I always go with energy, and that is probably the one thing that I put it over the emotion of Just Breathe. And I don't take anything away from the emotion of Just Breathe, but Unthought Known just does something that not a lot of Pearl Jam songs from this era do. All right, let's go over what we did here and all the tiers. Third tier, we got Johnny Guitar, we got Supersonic, we got Force of Nature in the end. And then for the second tier, Got Some If You Need It, Fixer, which, honestly, I'm not going to do it. But I could flip-flop Supersonic for the Fixer on any given day. But I'm not going to do it at this point. Speed of Sound, I think that Speed of Sound had a chance to make the first tier, but didn't quite make it. So Speed of Sound is going to stay in a second, but I think it's very high. I think Speed of Sound is much higher on this list than Got Some or the Fixer. So, and honestly, I'm going to fuck with things. Why not? I'm putting Speed of Sound in the first tier. And I'm going to put Supersonic. That way, this is pretty balanced. This is pretty balanced now. So the third tier now has three songs. The second tier now has three songs. And the first tier is sitting pretty well with the usual four songs. So, yeah, that's what I got here. And look, the first tier is going to be Gonna See My Friend, Just Breathe, Amongst the Waves, Speed of Sound. Again, listen to Speed of Sound again. It's a great song. Unthought Known is the winner. Unthought Known is going to the championship game as the Super Tier song from this record. Well, I hope you all enjoyed what I did here today. Again, not one of my favorite records, so it's not one that I kind of put a lot of thought, a lot of effort into, not on purpose, but you know, it's tough because I honestly, studio album wise, I haven't listened to these songs in a pretty long time, so I needed to kind of trace back to my memory to see what kind of feeling I was grabbing from them, and this is just about it. So hey, you know this channel. If you're subscribed to this channel, then why not listen to the podcast? The Live on Four Legs podcast, well, every week we put out a show every Wednesday, and it's always a different live performance of Pearl Jam. It could be any time in their history, from back in 1994, when they were doing shows like the Orpheum, when they were doing shows like, there's a cool show in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, that we're going to do some point in the future, and then even the Backspacer era. We will go back to the Backspacer era. There's a ton of really, really good 2010 shows out there that I would like to touch up on in the future, absolutely. So yeah, anything from any era. And look, we're always looking for requests, especially if you decide you want to join our Patreon. Our Patreon has so many extra exclusive episodes that you can listen to, from Evolution episodes where we go through a song and kind of talk about the beginning stages of it, and then kind of to where it is today, and we tell a full story, to shows about the British School, to shows about some of their late night TV live performances, like on SNL, on Letterman, and places like that. And, you know, just the community, you know, we like to do a lot for our patrons. We like to kind of give back, even for $1 a month, is, you know, that's very helpful to us. And look, we have a tour coming up, so everything is kind of going into stuff that we're doing on the tour. So if you want to help us out, head on over to patreon.com/liveandfourlegs, or what you can do is go to liveandfourlegs.com. On the main page, there's a button that says become a patron, and maybe that's what you do to join. So again, we love all our patrons. We thank them, and we also thank everybody else as well for watching, for subscribing, and you guys are great. If you want to join Patreon at some point in the future, you're more than welcome to, but again, we like you guys all the same. So thanks everybody for tuning in, and until Lightning Bolt, we're almost at the end here, but we're not quite there. TBD, we'll find out next week. See you then.